Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Autumn Ghost, How the Battle Against a Polio Epidemic Revolutionized Modern Medical Care, by Hannah Wunsch. Narrated by Emily Durante. Introduction. In 2020, COVID-19 catapulted intensive care into the public's consciousness across the world. The complex life-saving support provided in these units became headline news. But until quite recently in medical history, there was no intensive care. 70 years ago, anyone who struggled to breathe, whose heart gave out, or whose kidneys shut down would be kept comfortable and left to die. There were no ventilators, no monitors keeping track of vital signs minute to minute, no expertise of nurses and physicians to keep critically ill patients alive, and no dedicated units in hospitals for the care of such patients. Eugene Brunwald, a cardiologist, wrote about his experience of caring for patients in 1952. "We admitted patients with heart attacks wherever a bed was available on the medical service, but always as far from the nurse's station as possible so that they would not be disturbed by the commotion, especially the frequent telephone ringing. It was not uncommon for me, when arriving on the medical floor at 6 a.m. to draw blood to be sent for testing, to discover that one of my patients had died quietly during the night. Older physicians accepted this as just the way it was." This is the story of how we got from 1952 to now. In particular, it is the story of one disease that was nearly forgotten, polio. First came the dreaded virus, causing epidemics in the early 20th century and leaving paralysis in its wake. Then came the miracle of a vaccine. But before the vaccine and the near eradication of the virus, polio had a wider impact on the medical world, driving innovation in both hospital and rehabilitation care. This is a story of the citizens of one city, Copenhagen, from their resistance to occupation during a real war in the early 1940s to their extraordinary fight to save lives during a war against polio in the summer and fall of 1952. It is a tale of two doctors, one a consummate insider, Henry Kai Alexander Lassen, and one a complete outsider, Bjorn Oe Ibsen, as well as a story of over 1,000 medical and dental students who set aside their own lives to help patients breathe. It is a story of those patients who died from polio and others who lived to share their experiences and fight for rehabilitation and disability rights. Finally, it is the story of how a convergence of courage, coincidences, experience, and knowledge from disparate medical fields helped transform routine medical care for millions and propelled the world into the era of modern intensive care. A few notes on references and terminology. Any descriptions or details that are included come from sources such as photographs, interviews, or publications. References for all quotations and many other statements are provided in the notes at the end of the book. I've made it clear in the text the few times I have chosen to speculate. I have also simplified some of the Danish naming for English-speaking audiences. All quotations used in the text from Danish language source material were translated by native Danish speakers. Poetry by Rosa Abrahamsen was translated by Michael Favala Goldman. The book also includes some words, particularly related to disability, that may be considered outdated or offensive to modern audiences. I have chosen to include these words and place them in the context of the time, rather than exclude quotations because of their use. Different countries and cultures may have distinct preferences for how to describe people with disabilities. I have tried to use terminology that is respectful to all, and I hope listeners will forgive any choices that are not their preferred phrasing. August 1952, Copenhagen. Vivi Ebert was just 12 years old. She was going to die. Near the end of August, Vivi came home from school saying she had a headache and went to bed. The next day, she complained that she couldn't move her arms and legs well. On Tuesday, August 26th, she had a fever, headache, stiff neck, and some paralysis, the telltale signs of polio. Her mother called an ambulance, and Vivi was brought to the hospital. She already had weakness in one arm, but much more concerning, she also had difficulty breathing. Since early July, the hospital had admitted many patients just like Vivi, and almost all of them had died. As her symptoms worsened, the doctors and nurses knew she likely had only a few more hours, or days at most, to live. The polio epidemic that year in Copenhagen had begun with a trickle of cases in July. By the end of the summer, the disease was roaring through Denmark's capital and outlying regions. It was far worse than in previous years, with more cases of paralysis and difficulty breathing than anyone had ever seen. There were daily news bulletins on the radio announcing the latest areas with outbreaks. Ambulances kept pulling up at the hospital hour after hour, day after day. By late August, there were 50 admissions a day, all with severe polio. The doctors and nurses would have focused on one key question: could the patient take a breath? For someone who was struggling to breathe, there was little that could be done except to try to keep them comfortable. Henry Kai Alexander Lassen, the chief of the Blydam, the only infectious disease hospital in the city, was a physician and an expert on polio. He had cared for hundreds of patients with the illness. But this strain of the virus seemed to be causing more cases than usual and was viciously deadly. By the time Vivi showed up, he and his team had already lost dozens of patients, many of them infants and children. Vivi was about to be next. The previous decades had been full of major medical advances. Antibiotics allowed for treatment of bacterial infections. The discovery of insulin meant that a diagnosis of diabetes was no longer a death sentence, and X-rays provided a way to see inside the body. New vaccines had even been developed for infectious diseases such as diphtheria and influenza. But in 1952, there was still little anyone could offer as treatment for patients with polio, and there was also no vaccine for prevention. Modern medicine was failing, and polio was winning. That was about to change. Part 1. The Specter Rises. 1. Don't eat the apples. Standing tall above the entrance of the Blydam Hospital, Pallas Athena, the Greek goddess of wisdom and war, looked out over Copenhagen. Since 1879, she had stood guard, with spear and shield in hand, helmet on her head, and flowing gown clinging to her body. Flanked by three children she protected from the arrows of the plague god, Athena gazed to the left, down the tree-lined Blydam Road, watching as the sick made their way to the entrance, by ambulance, in taxis and cars, and on foot, turning into the stone drive that led to the hospital entrance. All those in need were admitted, welcomed by a doorman in pressed dark trousers, white jacket, and cap. They were ushered through an elaborate carved entryway to be assessed by the doctors and nurses. But not all who entered came out again. In 1853, an outbreak of cholera in Copenhagen had killed about 2,000 people. Many residents of the city fled, camping out in tents in the open air of the countryside. The Lord Mayor and City Council determined to improve sanitation, water supplies, and housing, and also to provide better care for the sick. By 1863, the municipal hospital had opened, but it was quickly overcrowded. The authorities decided that two additional hospitals were needed, a large one to care specifically for those with infectious diseases, a fever hospital, and a smaller quarantine hospital near the harbor, where the ships came in carrying individuals who might be infected with myriad diseases. The fever hospital, the Blydam, was commissioned as the first true epidemic hospital in Denmark, to be situated on the outskirts of the city, distanced from any residential neighborhood. It was named for the ponds nearby, the word bly, meaning pale, and dam, meaning pond. The name was purported to refer to the whitening of canvas done by bleaching men, who would lay out the fabric in long rows on the shore to be bleached by the sun, then printed with colored patterns and turned into curtains and pillowcases. The Øresund Hospital, used for quarantine, was completed in 1876. The Bly Dam, opening 3 years later, was built like an army barracks, with multiple low buildings of one or two stories to allow adequate air circulation and to provide isolation for patients with virulent infections. The grounds were leafy, with gardens, trees, and attractive pathways winding between buildings. Initially, the hospital had the capacity to care for 312 patients, with another 100 in tents as needed. After its opening on April 1, 1879, the hospital saw a steady stream of patients with scarlet fever, diphtheria, measles, and croup, as well as a smattering of the more uncommon infections, such as smallpox, cholera, and typhus. In the first 50 years, there were 48,542 patients with diphtheria and 44,354 with scarlet fever. Patients were isolated and provided with general nursing. They were cared for rather than treated, as there were no antibiotics or effective medications. As demand grew, the hospital expanded, adding new buildings to care for the endless stream of infected individuals. By 1921, the Bly Dam could accommodate 499 patients, including 72 in isolation rooms. In 1939, an ear, nose, and throat, ENT, department was added. In 1946, after the introduction of penicillin led to a substantial decrease in cases of diphtheria and scarlet fever, four of the buildings were no longer needed and were converted to a new general medicine ward. Modern medicine was beginning to provide the tools to conquer infectious diseases. In those early years, the doctors and nurses in the Bly Dam rarely saw poliomyelitis. Polio, as it is commonly known, is caused by a virus. While in many the illness is mild, in an unlucky minority, polio attacks nerves in the spinal column and the brainstem, resulting in paralysis of limbs, difficulty breathing, and sometimes death. The virus has probably been around since antiquity, but the only references in early texts are vague, descriptions of lameness and withered limbs. An ancient Egyptian stone slab held at the Glyptotek, a museum in Copenhagen, depicts a priest with a shortened and thinned left leg, with his foot showing the traditional droop typical of flaccid paralysis from polio. However, the cause of this deformity remains speculative. John Paul, in his comprehensive book on the history of poliomyelitis, notes that Hippocrates, who described several infectious diseases in ancient Greece, does not describe polio. The disease is thought to have been endemic, meaning that it was widely present. But because it seemed to cause little paralysis, it generally went unnoticed. By the 18th century, descriptions that more clearly matched those of paralytic polio began to surface. In a prelude to the hundreds of thousands of similar stories to come, Sir Walter Scott, the great writer born in 1771 in Edinburgh, described his own experience at 18 months of age with what was most likely a case of polio. "I was discovered to be affected with the fever. It held me 3 days. On the fourth, when they went to bathe me as usual, they discovered that I had lost the power of my right leg." Sporadic cases with paralysis were recognized in the 1800s, and polio gradually came to be viewed as a disease separate from other well-known maladies of childhood, such as scarlet fever and the bloody flux, dysentery. There were no epidemics, but polio was lying in wait, biding its time. The outbreak that ultimately caught the world's attention cropped up around Stockholm in 1887. Carl Oscar Medin, an experienced and well-respected pediatrician in Sweden, had seen occasional cases over the previous decade. But when an epidemic of paralytic polio involving 44 children occurred in the Stockholm region, Medin investigated cases as they occurred, with an attention to clinical observation and follow-up of the individual patients. In August 1890, he presented his findings in detail to a large audience at the 10th International Medical Congress in Berlin. It was the first clear description of this epidemic disease from, as Paul described him, a thoroughly reliable, articulate, and experienced pediatrician. Many people had the disease with no symptoms at all. For those who did show symptoms, they usually included fever, fatigue, vomiting, diarrhea, and headache for a few days. For most, these minor symptoms resolved without any other manifestation of the disease. As the 20th century neared, a small percentage of cases progressed to paralysis, sometimes immediately and sometimes after the initial symptoms had cleared. In 1917, this sequence of two humps, minor symptoms, then an initial reprieve, followed by the onset of paralysis, was inaccurately dubbed the dromedary form of polio. What remained a complete mystery during these investigations was how people contracted polio. The concept of contagion, which was by then well established for diseases such as smallpox, did not seem to be considered. After 1887, paralytic polio cases remained sporadic. The first big outbreak documented in the U.S. was in Rutland County, Vermont, in 1894. The local general practitioner, Charles Solomon Caverly, also the president of the Vermont State Board of Health since 1891, took careful observations and followed up with each patient, reporting on 132 cases, including 18 deaths. His detailed description of the epidemic of 1894 was recognized as a key contribution to understanding this previously unnoticed disease. Vermont was a harbinger of things to come. So many people in the state had developed paralytic polio that Caverly and a colleague, Robert W. Lovett, an orthopedic surgeon, set up clinics and then hospitals to provide care for those who were left with physical disabilities. The need for such facilities would spread across states and countries over the next 50 years. Caverly died in 1918 from another disease that swept the globe, influenza. By the start of the 20th century, this new epidemic nature of polio, with clustered cases of paralysis, was recognized by the medical establishment. Medin's assistant, Ivar Wickman, added an important additional piece to the puzzle. Polio was contagious. Equally important, he recognized that many people with mild symptoms that may have been mistaken for other ailments, or even those who were asymptomatic, could in fact have polio, and these individuals could transmit the disease. Until then, doctors and public health officials had focused on counting only those who experienced paralysis. For parents, paralysis was all that really mattered. A mild fever or headache passed, like many other childhood illnesses. But from the perspective of epidemiology, counting those milder cases to understand the extent of the disease and who was at risk was essential. By including those cases with only minor symptoms, Wickman could trace outbreaks that started with transmission in schools and demonstrate how the virus then traveled into homes, and from there onto other towns and cities, infecting individuals along the way. In 1916, polio hit the U.S. with an epidemic larger than had ever been seen. The first wave started in May and early June, with an official announcement in a press bulletin on June 17th of a polio epidemic in Brooklyn, New York. The city's mayor declared New York in a state of great and imminent peril, and expanded the emergency powers of the Department of Health. The U.S. Public Health Service sent in officials, epidemiologists, and infectious disease experts. By mid-August, there were 6,653 cases of polio in New York and thousands across other states. Public gatherings were restricted, with playgrounds and children's rooms and libraries closed, children banned from movie theaters, and streetcars and public telephones disinfected every night. Sunday schools were closed and circuses performed to audiences without children. While people understood by then that polio was somehow transmissible, the details of exactly how it spread remained out of reach. In 1908, Carl Landsteiner, a Viennese biologist who later won the Nobel Prize for his discovery of blood groups, along with his assistant, Erwin Popper, identified polio as a filterable virus, paradoxically meaning it evaded being strained out. The virus slipped through a Birkfeld candle, a filter made up of billions of skeletons of microscopic marine organisms that created channels so small that they trapped bacteria. Landsteiner and Popper conducted a simple experiment. First, they took spinal cord fluid from a person who had died of the disease. Next, they poured this fluid through the filter. When they injected this finely filtered fluid into monkeys, the monkeys developed polio. Landsteiner and Popper correctly deduced that there had to be some causative agent that was smaller than any bacterium. Even without being able to see it under a microscope, they knew the virus had to be there. Remarkably, the work carried out on viruses up through the early 1950s was done without ever being able to see the virus. Polio was an infectious agent that mostly remained theoretical, although the paralysis it caused was certainly real. Despite Landsteiner and Popper's work to identify the causal agent and Wickman's observations that showed people were contagious, exactly how the virus got from person to person was unclear. Was it through touch, animals, insects, the air? Many diseases were more common and more severe in deprived areas owing to a lack of sanitation and clean water. Cholera and typhoid fever, for example, occurred where sewage and drinking water mixed, with outbreaks most often in slums. Despite a recognition by public health experts that these diseases were successfully eradicated when the real danger was identified and removed, for instance, by improving the sewage system, a general view remained pervasive that filth and disease ran hand in hand. And so the predominant theory was still that polio transmission would be reduced only through attention to personal cleanliness and general hygiene and a reduction in filth of all kinds in the environment. Many untested theories related to poorer areas took hold, including that polio was carried by flies, leading to a huge Swat the Fly campaign and a focus on placing screens around babies to keep flies from landing on them and transmitting the disease. Cats and other domestic animals also became suspect. On July 26th, the New York Times reported that 80,000 cats and dogs, although mostly cats, had been slaughtered that summer because of fear of polio transmission. Milk and dust were both considered as potential vectors, and the milk supplies were scrutinized, with both pasteurized and unpasteurized milk coming under attack. The idea that objects could be carriers for the disease also remained a concern. In New Jersey, people traveling from New York were barred from entry if carrying rags or paper, and children were restricted from traveling at all. In New York City, library books were burned if returned from a home where infection was known. Children with polio could be forcibly removed to hospitals as part of the campaign to reduce transmission of the disease. Some families resisted having their children taken and even actively concealed them from health workers. The wealthy fled to the countryside, hoping to avoid exposure. By the time it was over, the 1916 epidemic had killed a total of 6,000 people in the U.S., with more than 2,000 in New York alone, and the virus had paralyzed 27,000 across the country. Polio had arrived with a vengeance and was here to stay. In the aftermath of the outbreak, public health officials remained baffled, Around 80% of the cases were children under the age of 5. But children in rural counties who got the disease tended to be older and were also more likely to die. Poor immigrants were stricken, but so too were middle-class children. Boys were more commonly affected than girls, and black children were seemingly less likely to get sick than whites. Staten Island was a particular mystery. The incidence there was the highest in the 5 boroughs, yet the population density was much lower and the poverty rate was also low. Most of the families on Staten Island were not immigrants and lived in houses with a high standard of sanitation, often including indoor toilets. Wade Frost, an epidemiologist for the federal government, had in 1911 made the same observation. Those in rural areas were more susceptible and tended to contract polio at an older age than those in cities. Nonetheless, the perception remained ingrained that cleanliness and staying away from urban environments would help keep polio at bay. Although many theories of transmission swirled across New York City during the 1916 outbreak, researchers in Sweden had already correctly identified the mechanism in 1912. The team, led by Carl Kling at the State Bacteriological Institute, had demonstrated that they could isolate the polio virus in the human intestinal tract. This finding suggested the route of transmission, through the mouth and the gut, then into the bloodstream, where it would travel to the nerves of the spinal cord and brain. These Swedish researchers presented their findings at an international conference in Washington, D.C., but for unknown reasons, their theory received an indifferent response, and it would be decades before its truth was recognized. Many polio researchers and doctors believed instead that polio entered the body through the nose and then traveled directly to the nerves in the brain. This nasal theory was championed by Simon Flexner, the extremely powerful director of the Rockefeller Institute in New York City. Founded in 1901, the Rockefeller Institute was a hotbed for polio research. Studying polio was hard because it did not naturally infect animals. At the time, only monkeys were known to be susceptible, so research on polio required access to these animals, which were expensive and difficult to handle. But the Rockefeller Institute was rich, and Flexner procured monkeys. Flexner then made a devastatingly costly error. He chose to use a specific monkey, the macaca mulata, rhesus monkey. While other monkeys are susceptible to polio, the rhesus monkey is more resistant to infection, particularly via the oral route, and can only become infected reliably by injecting the virus directly into the brain or spinal cord. Flexner did experiments on his rhesus monkeys, sticking swabs with the polio virus all the way up their noses. The monkeys got sick, and he could isolate the virus in the olfactory nerves as well as in parts of the brain. In a report in 1910, Flexner, with his colleague Paul Lewis, commented authoritatively, "The experimental results show that a path of elimination of the virus of poliomyelitis is by way of the nasopharyngeal mucosa, and indicate that the same path may be traversed in the course of infection." Nobody thought to question whether assessment in humans, or even a different species of monkey, might yield other results. Because Flexner and his colleagues were so persuasive, this misunderstanding regarding the route of transmission lasted for decades. Lots of effort went into finding a way to protect people by blocking up their noses so the virus could not enter. One trial in Toronto in 1937 used a zinc sulfate nasal spray as prophylaxis, to no avail. By the early 1940s, Flexner's nasal theory had been overturned. A study in 1938 showed that the polio virus could be detected in the stool of patients, which would be unlikely had the virus been transmitted via the nasal route. Work by Albert Sabin, a researcher at the University of Cincinnati, and others in the 1940s showed that other types of monkeys could become infected with polio if fed the virus, and also that the virus could almost never be isolated in the olfactory bulb, the nose, of infected individuals. It was definitive. The virus was transmitted primarily by the fecal-oral route. This meant people ingested it and then passed it on to the next person through their stool, an enterovirus. Dirty water could be a route of transmission, although usually it was transferred through unwashed hands and fecal material on objects. While the mechanism of transmission was grasped by the scientists working on polio research, this did not readily translate into an understanding by the general public. Moreover, even scientists still did not understand why one person got very sick and another didn't. An encounter with the virus led to an asymptomatic disease in most. Exposure occurred, the body fought off the virus, then an individual was immune, unaware of the battle that had taken place. If symptoms did occur, they were mild. These bouts were termed abortive. Only a small percentage of people exposed to polio, the unlucky few, developed paralysis. The average incubation before onset of symptoms was often estimated to be 10 days, but was observed to be anywhere from 2 to 35. Exposure could occur a solid month before symptoms appeared. The onset of symptoms could be insidious, and one virologist, Thomas Rivers, remarked, "It would be easy enough if polio began with a sudden nosebleed or if the patient's head fell off, but polio was never that nice and easy." Moreover, infectious virus particles could linger in the feces for several weeks or more following the initial infection. The fact that the rich and well cared for, with the luxury of good hygiene, as well as those in rural locations, far from the slums and unsanitary conditions of inner cities, were as susceptible or more so to polio, infuriated many and added to the hysteria. Speculation ran rampant about how to protect people. Across the U.S., swimming pools, cinemas, and schools were routinely closed when polio appeared. Children in Sweden were warned, "Do not kick in the leaves. Do not eat those apples. They've been on the ground." Likewise, children in Denmark, even after the advent of the vaccine, were also warned to never eat an apple off the ground and to always, always wash the fruit before eating it. Antibodies to polio could be passed to an infant in mother's milk, so babies who were exposed while being breastfed had the benefit of this maternal protection to help them fight off the virus. And once they did, they were immune. This was the great paradox. Playing around in the dirt at a very young age and being exposed to fecal material due to less sanitary conditions meant early exposure to the polio virus that would usually confer lifelong immunity. But as sanitary conditions slowly improved in different regions, particularly over the course of the 1800s, some babies stopped getting this early exposure. This explained the confusing findings on Staten Island. A generation of children, raised in the relatively sanitary conditions of uncrowded homes with indoor toilets, were not exposed at an early age and were therefore still susceptible. A tragic example of polio's effect on a previously unexposed group of individuals occurred with an outbreak in a Canadian Inuit community in 1949. A missionary had visited polio patients at a hospital in Eskimo Point, now Arviat, before flying north into Chesterfield Inlet, a hamlet on the western shore of Hudson Bay. This missionary was thorough on his visit to Chesterfield Inlet. He went to see non-polio patients in the hospital and also visited widely in the settlement. He brought polio with him, exposing everyone. Out of a population of 275, there were 57 cases and 14 deaths. Most striking was the even distribution across all age groups. An epidemiologist in the Department of National Health and Welfare in Ottawa concluded, "This suggests an absence of immunity in the whole population. Deaths, however, are most marked in the age groups of 45 to 49 and 55 to 59. Inuit in this area had not seen the polio virus as children and made it all the way into their 50s or 60s without exposure. Two facts were clear by 1949. More older children and adults were getting polio, and contracting the disease at an older age made severe symptoms more likely, resulting in either paralysis or death. But the strain of polio mattered as well. Some versions were more virulent, while the majority of infections were either asymptomatic or involved only minor symptoms, usually accounting for 95% or more of cases, the percentage who became paralyzed could vary depending on the strain. This enigma of a disease went by many names. Polio became the moniker of choice from the longer phrase poliomyelitis anterior acuta, first used in 1874 from the Greek words polio, meaning gray, and myelon, meaning marrow, with the itis tacked on to mean inflammation, and anterior referring to the front part of the spinal cord, which was gray and was where the virus tended to attack, causing paralysis. But polio as a name for the disease had many other contenders, starting with the vague debility of the lower extremity in 1789, Heine-Medin disease, morning paralysis, tephromyelitis, tephro meaning ash in Greek, again referring to the gray portion of the spinal cord, acute spinal paralysis, and of course, infantile paralysis. This last term was finally dropped due to the confusion and often shame induced when an adult contracted a disease that was described as occurring in infants. In Denmark, it was similarly bornelammels, child paralysis. In tropical countries, the disease had little seasonality, usually with a low level of cases throughout the year. But in the colder climates, a polio season occurred during warmer months. In the U.S., the end of spring and start of summer heralded the next round of polio cases. Given this seasonality, in the U.S., polio was often known as the summer plague. No one could predict how bad it would be. Some years passed with relatively few cases, and even fewer that caused paralysis. Others were catastrophic. The 1916 epidemic followed the standard rules of engagement for polio in the U.S., peaking at the start of August and then decreasing in September, finally petering out in New York in November. But in more northern regions, such as Scandinavian countries, the polio season occurred slightly later. Polio slipped into the homes of healthy children as the summer waned and the equinox approached, with September and October often the cruelest months. Moving with a frightening uncertainty about where it would strike next and how badly, the virus had been described by one writer in Sweden as the autumn ghost. 2. That damn machine. By the 1920s, polio was menacing the world every year in different towns, cities, and countries. No one could predict where it would hit or how many it would fell. This virus that in the previous century had barely been a whisper of a disease was now causing terror, leaving paralysis and death in its wake. Doctors had little to offer. Bed rest was the mantra of the era. As far back as the 1890s, William Osler, a master diagnostician and sage physician, advocated doing very little for patients with polio. The child should be in bed and the affected limb or limbs wrapped in cotton, he wrote. In the 1920s, children with polio often lay immobilized in bed, day after day. The most devastating of all was when the virus attacked the nerves that controlled the muscles needed for breathing. Children would start gasping for breath. James L. Wilson, a resident, doctor in training, at Harvard during the 1920s, described the horror of caring for polio patients who were unable to breathe. Of all the experiences that the physician must undergo, none can be more distressing than to watch respiratory paralysis in a child ill with poliomyelitis, using with increasing vigor every available accessory muscle of neck, shoulder, and chin, silent, wasting no breath for speech, wide-eyed and frightened, conscious almost to the last breath. The challenge of how to help people who had lost the ability to breathe was not a new one. Well before paralytic polio arrived in the late 1800s, all kinds of problems caused people to stop breathing. Pneumonia was, of course, extremely common, but so were drownings and other accidents, such as gas poisoning. There was great interest in trying to figure out ways to resuscitate victims of drownings and other sudden events that led to death. Normally, the body sucks air into the lungs when the diaphragm pushes down into the abdomen and the ribs expand by using the chest muscles. This creates negative pressure inside the chest, forcing the lungs to expand to fill the void with air that rushes in through the mouth or nose, through the vocal cords, down the trachea and bronchi, and into the alveoli, the tissue of the lungs made up of tiny sacs of air. In the alveoli, gases diffuse between the air and the blood. Oxygen from the air gets delivered to the bloodstream, and carbon dioxide, the body's waste, moves from the blood into the air. In exhalation, the body just relaxes. The lungs naturally want to spring back, like a balloon after the knot holding the air in is untied. The diaphragm moves back up, the muscles of the chest wall relax, and the ribs return to their natural resting position. The air gets pushed back out of the trachea, through the mouth and nose. The whole system only works if there is no breach in the body. In 1543, Andreas Vesalius, an Italian anatomist, noted that when he opened the chest of a live animal, the lungs collapsed and the heart would stop shortly after. Over 100 years later, Robert Hooke, a scientist and architect who is perhaps best known for his visualization of microorganisms, repeated this observation. In 1664, he followed it up with an experiment where he used a bellows hooked up to a pipe that was put down the trachea and into the lungs of a dog, pumping air in and out. Hooke concluded, "It seemed very probable that this motion might have been continued as long, almost, as there was any blood left within the vessels of the dog." As some understanding of the anatomy and physiology developed, it became apparent there were two possible ways to get air into the lungs. Increase the negative pressure around the lungs so that the lungs are pulled open by the external forces, the way normal breathing occurs, or push air or other gas directly into the lungs with positive pressure, like blowing up a balloon, an approach considered unnatural. Many people experimented with both options through the 1800s and into the early 1900s without great success. A series of attempts by scientists in the early 1800s created artificial negative pressure by encasing the body in a box or tube and creating a seal around it with a bellows or pump to then remove air from the chamber and create the negative pressure necessary to force the rib cage to expand and the lungs to open. None of these devices gained much traction, as they were cumbersome, prone to leaks, and required someone to man the bellows or pump continuously. Then children began to die from polio. The first major breakthrough in the care of polio patients came from an unlikely source, a professor of industrial hygiene at the Harvard School of Public Health. Philip Drinker did not set out to change care for polio patients. What interested Drinker most were problems such as air pollution in factories and occupational injuries. Drinker was born in Haverford, Pennsylvania, on December 12, 1894, the year of the first major polio outbreak in the U.S. He studied chemical engineering at Lehigh University before enlisting in the Army in 1917. He was stationed overseas to work on the preparation of airplane fuselage coatings, and after the war, worked as an industrial engineer, focusing on understanding the health problems associated with air pollution in factories and shipyards, and devising approaches to improve the safety of the working environment. His big brother, Cecil, a professor at Harvard, secured him an appointment at the same institution, sending him a telegram. Expect you January 15, $250 a month, and title Instructor in Applied Physiology, Harvard Medical School, Department of Applied Medicine, Good Business, Cecil. And so in 1921, Philip Drinker took up a position at Harvard Medical School as an instructor in applied physiology, and then in 1923 became an instructor of ventilation and illumination at the new School of Public Health at Harvard, where his brother was now also a professor. The two were chalk and cheese. Cecil liked his days planned out, a paragon of organization. Philip, according to his sister, banged along, enjoying life as it came. In the early 1920s, over 2,000 people in the U.S. died of poisoning by gases and vapors every year. So in 1926, Drinker was appointed to a newly formed commission at Rockefeller Institute, charged with improving methods of resuscitation from gas poisoning and electric shocks. This work was supported by the New York Consolidated Gas Company, which had a vested interest in improving such technology. Around this same time, Philip Drinker's brother, along with a colleague, Louis Agassiz Shaw, was tinkering with a method to measure the breathing of different animals, including the cat. They placed an anesthetized animal inside a plethysmograph, a metal box attached to a spirometer, which measures pressure, and a device to measure changes in volume. One of Shaw's questions, which he answered in a publication in 1928, was whether cats, and mammals in general, could breathe through their skin. Back in 1904, August Crow, a Dane, had shown that pigeons, tortoises, frogs, and eels absorbed oxygen through the skin and gave off carbon dioxide. Eels did this so efficiently that they had no need for gills. At the opposite extreme was the tortoise, whose heavy coat made exchange of gas almost nil, wrote Shaw. But mammals had not been studied. Shaw sealed the cat in with its head sticking out. He could then measure how much air was going in and out of the lungs as the cat breathed by looking at a U-shaped tube half filled with water. When the cat inhaled, the water level changed, and they could calculate how much air had entered the cat's lungs. Because the plethysmograph made a seal around the cat's body, Shaw could also determine if gas was being exchanged through the cat's skin, and not just through the lungs, by sampling the gas within the box. He concluded that mammals did not use their skin to breathe. Philip Drinker watched these experiments and seemed aware of possible applications to humans and their breathing. He conducted his own experiment by paralyzing a cat with curare, sealing it in the box, and then pumping air in and out by hand using a syringe, keeping the cat alive for a few hours. By pulling air out of the box, he created negative pressure, as others had done before him, sucking air down the cat's trachea and into the lungs. When he pushed air back into the box, the pressure increased again. The lungs could recoil along with the rib cage, causing the cat to exhale. Intrigued, Drinker and Shaw began to tinker further, using cats for their experiments, and showed that they could keep such paralyzed animals alive indefinitely by breathing for them. He noted that we mechanized the pumping mechanism, and we did keep one alive for some 12 hours. There wasn't much point in going any further. His co-conspirator with the cats, Louis Agassiz Shaw, Jr., came from an illustrious background on both sides. The son of Louis Agassiz Shaw, Sr. and Mary Elizabeth Saltonstall, he had roots that extended back to the Mayflower. But his family wasn't just full of Boston blue bloods. There was a scientist in the family cabinet of curiosities for whom Shaw was named. His great-grandfather was Louis Agassiz, a noted professor of zoology and geology at Harvard, known particularly for his contributions to the classification of fish and his eugenicist views. Shaw graduated from Harvard in 1909, living in a large Boston mansion on Marlborough Street that he had inherited from his grandmother. Shaw applied himself to physiology experiments, setting up a home laboratory. From October 1917 until January 1919, the 10 people working for him conducted investigations upon the physiological effects of poisonous gases and other Allied war problems, as he stated in his Harvard class report. He was the ultimate gentleman scientist, working out of his own house without an academic affiliation. However, in the spring of 1919, he joined the faculty of the Harvard-MIT School for Health Officers in the Department of Industrial Hygiene, later becoming an instructor at the Harvard School of Public Health. In 1921, Shaw was arrested for distilling alcohol in his home. In gleeful articles, the New York Times reported that society circles in the Back Bay have been invaded by prohibition officers, naming Shaw, in whose home was found one of the finest stills that the Prohibition era has brought to official attention. The still was on the top floor of the house, next to the ballroom, along with 5.5 gallons of distilled liquor and 6 gallons of mash. Luckily for polio victims and the medical world, Shaw was acquitted on a technicality. The search warrant that had turned up the still was strangely made out in the name of John Shaw. In the end, he was left free to make his observations of animals at Harvard. Drinker joined Shaw in experimenting with his cats, and they ultimately published their observations on animal ventilation in 1929. Having established that he could keep a paralyzed cat alive for many hours, Drinker traveled to New York to tell this to his friends in the gas company. He asked them to give him some money to make a man-sized machine that would be big enough to hold him, and they said sure. According to his sister, Drinker took the money home and began by asking a tinsmith to make a box big enough for a man. A closet at the school contained a number of secondhand vacuum cleaners, discarded by a company in New York State that manufactured industrial fans. With two of these cleaner motors and a generous amount of adhesive tape, Phil made a pump and hooked it to the box. To slide a patient into the tank, they used a garage mechanic's creeper, the wheeled board that slides a person under the chassis of a car. An ongoing concern was the collar for the neck, something that had stymied many earlier attempts at creating an effective negative pressure box. The collar had to be tight enough to make a complete seal and avoid leaks, but not so tight as to decrease blood flow in the neck, which would reduce oxygen to the brain. Philip Drinker wrote to his brother Cecil about the problem. Cecil's reply from Copenhagen, where he was on sabbatical, was that if the collar was tight enough to maintain the seal, it would definitely cut off circulation. Luckily, Philip hadn't waited for his brother's gloomy answer and had already found success with a rubber collar. Ultimately, Drinker and Shaw consulted Clewitt Peabody and Company, collar manufacturers, and the Knox Hat Company to get accurate measurements of adult-sized necks and took their own measurements on infants and children to make a full array of collars of different sizes, built by hand to their own specifications to be ready for a patient of any size. Once they had finished experimenting on cats, and with the human-sized version complete, Drinker and Shaw moved on to experimenting on themselves. First, Drinker himself went into the box, and then Louis Frenney, a morgue worker at Harvard who was assisting them. Drinker was not a physician and was unfamiliar with polio patients. He was originally thinking about resuscitating workers who had accidents. However, during the same period as he was experimenting with cats, Drinker was approached by the physician-in-chief of Children's Hospital Boston, Kenneth D. Blackfan, to help with the care of premature infants. Blackfan had recognized that premature infants could not regulate their temperature, which fluctuated with the ambient air, adding to their risk of death. He knew that keeping these infants at a steady temperature would help them survive. In a precursor to modern incubators, Drinker designed conditioned nurseries in which the air temperature could be tightly controlled, procuring fans, blowers, and other needed equipment through his relationships with various gas and electric companies. According to Drinker, it was an awkward nursing problem to maintain a warm, humid room for these infants, and then expect the nurses and doctors to go in and out and not get alternately hot and cold, and individual incubators became the preferred method for care. But while the rooms were in use, Drinker was frequently called to make adjustments to these hothouses. On one of these visits, Black Fan and his colleague James Gamble mentioned that they needed help for children in the terminal stages of respiratory paralysis from polio. With some misgivings, Drinker went to the children's hospital wards. He saw a couple of these unfortunate children expire and described it as a harrowing experience. His sister wrote that he could not forget the small blue faces, the terrible gasping for air. And so Drinker's plans unexpectedly shifted from the resuscitation of gassed and electrocuted workers to polio patients. He and Shaw did further testing, figuring out how to get a good seal on their tank and determining how much negative pressure to exert to suck open the lungs consistently. They also noted that when the body was sealed into the metal tank and the pump wasn't running, it quickly got too hot, and they needed a way to cool down the interior of the machine. They fitted a small blower to the box that would contain the body and circulated the air through a can of ice, which both dehumidified and cooled the air. For all this refinement, they used as test subjects normal men and women chosen at random from the laboratory personnel in the building. The new machine was finally ready to their satisfaction, and they tried it out on a patient on October 13, 1928. Bertha Richard was 8 years old and lived with her father, Alexander, a construction worker, and her mother, Madeline, in Waltham, Massachusetts. She had been sick for 3 days, developing a fever, headache, and stiffness of the neck and back. By the time she was admitted to Children's Hospital Boston on Friday, October 12th, her left arm was weak and she had difficulty breathing. She received a spinal tap, a procedure that was used to help confirm the diagnosis of polio. Knowing Bertha had little chance of survival, the pediatrician Charles McCann called Drinker and Shaw. They wheeled their new contraption over to the children's hospital and left it in the little girl's room. They turned it on next to her bed so she could get used to the sound. The early pump used was very loud. James Wilson, who had described watching children with polio dying, was one of the pediatrics residents at Bertha's bedside. He remembered the first iron lungs being so noisy that in the summer, with the windows open, one could hear it running for a quarter of a mile away. By the afternoon of October 13th, Bertha's breathing was worse, and at 4 p.m. she was placed in the machine, mostly to test it out to make sure it was working and get her used to it. She did well. They took her out, as they felt she didn't really need it yet. But Bertha was clearly deteriorating. First, the muscles of her chest and neck had become paralyzed, and soon her diaphragm as well. By 6 a.m. she was struggling to breathe, with the telltale blue lips and fingers showing a lack of oxygen in her body. She was put back into the machine. This time, Drinker and McCann increased the pressure, setting up to negative 30 centimeters of water, so that with each cycle, the machine created that much negative pressure in the chamber around her body, sucking the lungs open. As the pressure fell back to zero and then swung to a positive pressure, 15 centimeters of water, the lungs would collapse back down, causing her to exhale. In just 15 minutes, she improved dramatically. When she was able to speak, she asked for ice cream. Drinker was so relieved he started to cry. Bertha was briefly removed from the machine and placed back in her own bed, but by 4 p.m. the same day, she was back in the respirator. She described that she could breathe bigger in the machine. The residents took turns sitting with her day and night. Despite the machine, pneumonia overwhelmed her, and she died at 8 p.m. on October 19th, aged just 8 years, 7 months, and 10 days. She had been in the new contraption, supported in her breathing, for 122 hours. The experiment was nonetheless deemed a success. Before the pneumonia had set in, when the problem was just the paralysis from polio, Bertha had been comfortable and able to breathe and even speak when in the machine. One of the next patients to receive the support of the new device was Barrett Hoyt, a Harvard student. He was an assistant manager for the varsity ice hockey team and an undergraduate just a year away from finishing his degree when he was admitted with polio to the nearby Peter Bent Brigham Hospital on September 13, 1929. He was gasping and choking when placed into the giant tube. Within a few minutes, he simply said, "I breathe." Barrett, described later by Drinker as having experienced a long siege in the machine, ultimately recovered. Drinker and Shaw published their careful observations about the construction and use of the new device in the Journal of Clinical Investigation. Through better engineering and access to electricity for the pump, they had succeeded when all previous attempts had failed. Suddenly, respiratory failure was not a death sentence. Their version of a negative pressure breathing machine caught on in the medical community. The first machines were purchased by the New York Consolidated Gas Company, and then production was taken over by Warren E. Collins Incorporated in Boston. Other hospitals started using the machines, and the New York Times and other papers began reporting on individual patients cared for in the new respirator and giving details on how they fared. The machine captured the public's imagination. The Drinker and Shaw respirator became the Drinker Collins respiratory, often shortened to the Drinker.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.